Good afternoon.
This is a trial class for that online teaching.
I think most of you will be enjoying in that Corona holidays in your rooms and homes. But along with that, we'll take some of the words for the study purpose. So for that, for the final year students, I will start that same topic what we are studying in that classroom. So I think we completed up to that point of disorders. So next is at the end of this point of disorders, we will start that large intestine. Soon after starting with the large intestine, the first thing will become that appendix. I think as your favorite topic for all of us. So most of the times in that first year dissection, we completed that appendix and studied about this. Okay, just some introduction about the appendix. I think you know about its size and shape and its length. The size will be 8 to 10 centimeters. And most of this will be your believing that when it's having a non-function. To tell very clearly, it's one of the lymphatic organ. Where it secretes some of the enzymes which will be helps in absorption process. So, appendix will be formed by that layers. Only two layers without any muscular layer. Like that in the small intestine, it's formed by that serous membrane, mucous membrane, serous membrane, muscular membrane, and submucous and mucous membrane. But here in the appendix, a tubular like structure, where it's not containing that any muscle layer. Only it's having a mucous membrane and covers with a serous layer. Appendix is a tube like structure. That several times we called it as a sac like because a tube means where there will be the two openings, but appendix will be having only one opening at cecum. There, the opening will be having one valve. You know that valve will be the valve of Gerlach. That means whatever the contents in the cecum will not enter into the appendix, but whatever the secretion in the appendix will be enters into the cecum very clearly. Okay, then so many times. Appendix will be remembering with that blood circulation. Appendix blood circulation will be having that mainly by the appendicular artery and one artery which will be identified by the Indian scientist, that's a Seshachalam's artery. Seshachalam's artery is one of the accessory artery which will be present in the appendix. Just come to the location of the appendix. That appendix will be located in the right iliac fossa, as you know. But some of the times, like sciatus inversus. At the time of a sciatus inversus, the appendix will be present at that right iliac fossa, where that all that abdominal visceral organs will be changes the place in the vice versa. That's called as a sciatus inversus. And sometimes that appendix will become at subhepatic, particularly at the time of a pregnancy, that's a appendix will be rises above and below that, particularly with the hepatus, that's what it's called as a subhepatic appendix. And sometimes appendix will be congenital absence. That's the congenital absence of the appendix. And next come to that particular anatomy. As I told, it's 8 to 10 centimeters long. And it's a particular, the root of the appendix, which will be present at 2 centimeters posterior medial to the ileocecal junction. Posterior medial to the ileocecal junctions. And the at the end of the pre-tinea coli. I think you know about the tinea coli. You know about the tinea coli. The tinea coli are the vertical strips of a large intestine, where this end up with the cecum. That end of this, all the three tinea coli will be end up with the appendix. And really, there are important thing position of the appendix. Appendix will be number of the position. Particularly, there is a five position. First common position will be that one, retrocecal position. That's the 70% of that. Present with that retrocecal position, also called as a 12 o'clock position. And second will be the 20% present with the pelvic position. And that pre-ileal, posterior, subsecal, and parasecal and subhepatic appendix. These are the position. To understand clearly the retrocecal position means behind the cecum. The appendix will be present behind the cecum. That's why it's called as a retrocecal position. And pelvic position means a cecum will be located in a right iliac fossa. The appendix will be diverted. The appendix will be directed towards the pelvic. extraction of the appendix from the cecum, from the root of the appendix, it will be direct towards the bladder. That means the pelvic area. That's a pelvic appendix in the 20% of the cases. And the next will be the preileal. Preileal means the same appendix will be present before the ileum, ileocecal entry, before the ileum and above that one. And another one will be the behind the ileum. That's called as a preileal and posterior. And the last one is a, so next one will be the subcecal, below the cecum, where that cecum will be there, below the cecum, which will be related with the inferior part of the visceral cavity, below the cecum, that's called as a subcecal. And another will be the paracecal, parallel to the cecum, that's the paracecal. And next will be the subhepatic appendix. As I told previously, that one, subhepatic means it's present with the, just below the liver, called as a subhepatic. Clear? Then, as I told, there's a appendix will be covered by that peritoneum, and like the same peritoneum, double layer will be formed as a mesoappendix, as we discussed in the anatomy classes. And it's having the two layers, what I discussed just now, serosa and mucosa layer. And its appendix will be very important. It's having a rich lymphoid follicles. Appendix will be formed by the rich lymphoid follicles. Because of that, appendicitis will be, inflammation of that lymphatic follicles will be. These lymphatic follicles are the protective natures that what you read in a Peyer's patches in the small intestine. Like the same here also, that appendix will be having that number of the lymphoid follicles which responds for that immunity, as well as it will protect some of the digestion purpose, and it will help with that particularly and appendicular orifice is occasionally guarded by an indistinct similar fold called as a mucous membrane known as a valve of Gerlach. As I told previously, there is one valve will be present at the opening of the cecum. The appendicular tube will be opening to the cecum, the valve will be present, that valve called as a valve of Gerlach. And again I told, that supply of the appendix that will be by the Schesser-Chalons as well as a appendicular artery. Okay, now come to that location of the appendix. Surface area, that means surface anatomy of the appendix. I think you would know about that McBurney is a one, Charles McBurney suggested early laparotomy and removal of the appendix. So he identified one point, that point will be an imaginary line drawn from the umbilicus to right iliac spine, right anterior superior iliac spine. That imaginary line will be drawn from the two points, umbilicus to right anterior superior iliac spine. That line will be cut 2/3 from the umbilicus, 1/3 from the right iliac spine. That point marked will be that McBurney's point. That will be the location of the appendix. So most of the times it will help at a time of examination purpose. When we will examining the appendix, appendicitis, it will be helps. So this is about that introduction of the appendix. Then we will discuss about that one, diseases of the appendix. The appendix disease will be commonly we are having that one, acute appendicitis, recurrent appendicitis, simple appendicitis and complicated appendicitis. These are the simple, every day-to-day common surgery, the first surgery will be done by the surgeon will be the appendicectomy after that eversion of the sac, the hydrocele. So the cause for the appendicitis, inflammation of the appendix called the appendicitis. So comes with that cause. So before that one, the incidence of the appendicitis. The appendicitis till now we are discussing about that one, appendix is one of the lymphoid follicles, full of the lymphoid follicles. Appendicitis will be occurs only with that young age, particularly early in age, near to 20 to 25 and before that. What is the cause for that one? Why that appendicitis will be occurs only in that early young age? Why not with that later middle age or old age? There will be rare in the older age also, but it's most of times completely absent with the middle age. The cause we are thinking that one, as that appendix will be related with the lymphatic system, like the same another example like tonsillitis. Tonsillitis will be there only with that school going children's. by consumption of ice cream, by the cold fridge items. By that tonsillitis will be occurs only in early age. But later on in adult age, rather than the tonsillitis, there will be the pharyngitis. That means most of the times we'll discuss that one. The GIT will be having a protective nature by these lymphatics, like tonsils, Peyer's patches, and appendix. These are the protective lymphoid follicles against the microorganisms present in the GIT. These are most working at a time of early young age, in the children and early young age. Once that young age will be started, at that time immunity power of the body will be increases, these will be subsided. So because of that one appendix will be one of that full of that lymphoid follicles. So its appendicitis will be occurs only in a early young age. One theory will be there. Okay, come to the etiology. So etiology, most of times the first will be by the racial and dietary factors, and second will be the familial susceptibility will be there, and some will be socioeconomic status. It's a common in the middle class and rich people. Until now, exact reasons are not known. Then, particularly in the appendicitis, there are two theories are there. That's also comes under the causes. One will be the obstructive theory, another one is a non-obstructive theory. What do you mean by obstructive theory? Just now at a time of anatomy, I told that one. Appendix will be the tubular-like structures which is hanging from the root of the appendix, which is 2 cm posterior medial to the ileocecal junction. This tube will be having only one opening, at an opening called as a valve of Jarlath, which will be opens in the cecum, and remaining will be the sac. Several times we will discuss it as a Kuldi's. So obstructive pathology and non-obstructive pathology, two causes will be the appendicitis. Obstructive pathology, when it's having only one opening towards the lumen of the cecum, that opening will be closed, obstructed by the hard cecum, obstructed by the some of that indigested food particles, and by the chronic constipation. If that valve of Jarlath near to the valve, if it's get obstructed, whatever the secretion will be there in the appendix will not enter into the cecum. That may be causes as a stasis and results with the infectious conditions commonly. And second one will be that non-obstructive. So particularly in the non-obstructive, remember about the GIT, whatever the food and that digestive juices and contents of that small intestine, that will be running continuously up to the rectum. But here, I think you know about that, I told discussed about in previous classes about Mycus diverticulum. Like a Mycus diverticulum, there is some space is available in the appendix also, particularly for the microorganisms, where when that organisms will be stayed with that Mycus diverticulum, when that organisms will be stayed at that enters into the appendix, it will becomes a safe room for them, where it does not come into contact with the acid and alkali. So most of the times that's the lumen of the appendix will be a special room, protective room for the organisms. So organisms of the GIT can be enters into the appendix and causes that inflammation. So most of the history will be that one. If the person will be suffering with that typhoid fever or any infectious disease of the small intestine, the next month there may be a susceptibility of that appendicitis can be occurs. That's a non-obstructive appendicitis. Non-obstructive appendicitis means that lumen will not be obstructed, the organs will be get lodged into it. But in the obstruction will be caused by that, as I told, the fecalites and the worms and the cysts and ova of that cyst of entamoeba, that can cause the appendicitis, and some of the worms also can cause the obstructive pathology. So these are two pathology, one is obstructive pathology, then is a non-obstructive pathology. So comes to that one, non-obstructive pathology, first one. It's a non-obstructive pathology, also called as a catarrheal appendicitis. the process of inflammation is slow and gradual. In the non-obstructive, the process of the inflammation is a slow and gradual. A mild attack may be completely resolved mucosal and submucosal edema can be appears. And sometimes ulceration of the appendix results in a bacterial invasion of the lymphoid tissue. Sometimes results with a gangrene perforation. That this is a non-obstructive appendicitis, also called as a catarrheal obstructive. Here, the lumen is not obstructed. Because of that, the organisms will be lodged with that tube of the appendix, the lumen of the appendix, which will be takes place some time, more time for that one, where the process of that inflammation will be slow. But it's a reverse in obstructive appendicitis, where that symptoms of abrupt vomiting will be more, pain is very severe, tender will be more. Because when that obstruction will be occurs with that lumen of that appendix, that will be increases that infectious level. So it will become that woolly sac, the stasis of that and it's a favorable atmosphere for that organisms and it will be there. That's a obstructive appendicitis. This is a mainly cause for that obstructive and non-obstructive, and these are the etiology along with that etiopathology. Then comes to the clinical features. So commonly to remember is here clinical features will be only three. That will be the what we call as a Murphy's syndrome. Murphy's syndrome means it will be starts with that vomiting, fever, and along with that pain in the right iliac fossa. So first comes to the pain. Which type of the pain will be better? So in the previous classes I discussed with you about the different types of pain. In that majorly four types. One will be the somatic, second will be the visceral pain, and third will be the sympathetic pain, and fourth will be the neurological pain. So in that here will be the visceral pain. Somatic pain means which will be occurs in the musculoskeletal system, but here abdominal viscera, there will be the visceral pain will be occurs. So visceral pain of the appendicitis. So again, here in the appendicitis, pain will not directly occurs in the right iliac fossa. The first pain will be, the disturbance will be, starts with the surrounding the umbilicus. That's a origin of the pain in appendicitis occurs in that surrounding the umbilicus, and later on it will be referred to the right iliac fossa. The question comes, why that pain will be referred from one place to another place? Pain will be occurred in the surrounding the umbilicus fossa, and it's referred to that right iliac fossa. So first the pain will be occurs that visceral pain, a disturbance caused by that infectious condition, and second one, that appendix will be inflamed completely. At that time the appendix will be come into contact, the pain will be percepted by the peritoneum. When that pain will be percepted by the peritoneum, at that time pain will become very severe. Pain will become very severe. That means always pain will be present with the right iliac fossa. When that patient will becomes to you, patient will not remember you, the pain was there in that surrounding umbilicus. When the patient comes to you, most of the times the pain will be there in the right iliac fossa. Then you can take the history about that one, that the pain was present with that surrounding umbilicus. Some patient may be remember, some patient may not be report that one. And remember here, pain will be shifted from the visceral pain first and then to the somatic pain. When it is coming into contact with that peritoneum, that will become a somatic pain. That's a severe pain will be occurs. So particularly, as I told that anatomy of that appendix will be movable. Appendix will be movable at that where it is present. I told that positions of the appendix depends upon the position, it will be movable. And sorry, it's not movable. Remember about the position. Position will be there. The total five positions I explained, sir. Remember, movable means the position will not be changed in a one person. Positions will be there, fixed for respective persons. If I have appendix with a retrocecal, that retrocecal position will be maintained until the lifelong. But don't think that one, the position of the appendix can be changed depend upon day to day. It's not possible. The position of the appendix will be in particular person, it will be fixed. But movable
movability will be there, not a major movement, like a to and fro movability will be there. And second will be the vomiting. So vomiting occurs because of the visceral pain. Vomiting occurs because of the infectious contents with the small intestine. Vomiting can occur once or twice along with the pain will be there. And until that emptying of the gastrin, vomiting will be relieved some of the pain. Vomiting will be empty that peritoneal cavity. It will be relieved some of the pain. It occurs once or twice until that emptying of the gastrin. And because of the vasovagal reflex, the vomiting will be continuous. And then appendicitis having that, when there is a vomiting, automatically there will be the anorexia will be there, and because of the infectious condition, the fever will be there. Okay, to wind up that one about the symptoms, mainly Murphy's tried, first will be the pain. Pain will be referring or shifting from one place to another place, from the surrounding the umbilicus to the shifting to that right iliac fossa. Second, vomiting. Third, fever. These three called as Murphy's syndrome. Murphy's syndrome. Don't confuse about the Murphy's sign. Murphy's sign will be there with that cholestasis. Murphy's syndrome. These are the group of the symptoms. Sign is different. Sign is particularly for that time of examination. You can find out that Murphy's sign with the particularly with the gallstones or cholelithiasis and cystitis. Okay. Then that extra symptoms along with that Murphy's sign, some of the extra symptoms also there with that appendicitis. In that extra symptoms will be that hematuria. So many times it's a confusious condition. Confusious condition. Why means a pain in a right iliac fossa and hematuria and along with the vomiting, these are the typical symptoms of the right ureter calculi. Here in the right ureter calculi also the same group of the symptoms will be there, but here in the appendicitis also same hematuria will be there. So when that hematuria will be there, as I told that appendix will be having a position, second position in 20 to 30% of the people, that the appendix will be directed towards the bladder. At that time, there is a chance of hematuria will be there, which will be irritate that one, ureters and bladders, and which can be resulted with hematuria. Then the next will be the constipation, and sometimes diarrhea can be occurs, particularly with the pre and post ileal, pre and post ileal portion of the appendix inflamed. Appendicitis will be occurs at that time. There is a both constipation as well as a diarrhea, both can be occurs. These are the typical group of symptoms of appendicitis. Okay. Now come to that particular signs of the appendix. Just now I told that one very clearly. When that patient will becomes like this group of signs and symptoms, you can confuse there will be the right ventricle. So to avoid all of these conditions, before the diagnosis, go for the diagnosis, you have to know about that one. A particular group of signs are there, where how to examine that one. So particularly the first one will be the coughing tenderness. Coughing tenderness. Here what happens? It's a very typical sign where you can easily elicit about that one right ureter calculi and appendicitis. So patient will be lie down on that supine position, and that knee will be folded. Then you have to ask the patient to cough. When the patient will be cough, the pain will be occurs particularly at the right iliac fossa. It will be that inflammation of appendicitis, acute appendicitis. If that pain will not be that much aggressive by the coughing tenderness, that will be the right ureter pain. It's very simple thing. When that patient will be cough, inflamed appendix will be moved by that pressure, by the contraction of abdominal muscles. So the movement of the inflamed appendix can be increases the pain. But the stone will be present with the right ureter, it will not movable by that cuff. The pressure exerted outside is not movable, means it's not formed the pain. But the pain will be occurs with the coughing tenderness because of that one increased or inflamed appendix. And next will be the rebound tenderness. Rebound tenderness. So you know about the tenderness. Rebound tenderness means here pain will be occurs by the deep palpation over the right left fossa also. Pain will be occurs by the deep palpation also. When you release the pressure, suddenly again pain will be occurs. I think you can remember about the hydatid cyst. What happens? By putting the pressure over that one, deep palpation over that right iliac fossa, appendix will be moved. Pressure will be felt and the appendix will be moved. And when you release the pressure, appendix will comes again to the normal place. Because it is inflamed, the pain will be there. That's a rebound tenderness, also called as a Blumberg sign. Also called as a Blumberg sign. Then, as you know, when there is an inflamed appendix will be there, and in particular sign of the acute abdomen, there is a muscle guarding and residuity will be there. And next sign will be the rosing sign. Rosing sign will be by the deep palpation of a left iliac fossa. Understand clearly, by the deep palpation of a left iliac fossa, the pain will be aggressive with the right iliac fossa. So you are palpating that deep palpation over the left iliac fossa, the pain will be occurs in the right iliac fossa. That will be show clear sign of that acute appendicitis. And the particularly there is a hyperesthesia. Hyperesthesia means the superficial pain. If patient will not allow you to touch that one, where the triangle will be formed. So triangle means from the umbilicus to that right iliac spine and pubic symphysis. That triangle called as a Sharon's triangle. At time of acute appendicitis, there will be the superficial severe pain will be there. Patient will not allow to touch. That's called as a surface hyperesthesia. Hyperesthesia of that Sharon's triangle. Then another two test will be there, Cobb's Sawyer's test and Cobb's obturator test. So it's very simple. I think I told at a time of anatomy about the abdominal muscles, anterior abdominal muscles and lateral abdominal muscles, and two muscles are there, posterior abdominal muscles. The two muscles are there, Sawyer's muscle and obturator muscle. These are the muscles which origin from the vertebral column to the lower limbs. Vertebral column to the lower limbs. Just these are travels by the two iliac fossa, both from the right and left side. If you imagine that anatomy of that pelvis, where that behind the cecum, the abdominal wall, the two muscles, psoas and obturator, will be travels back. That's called as the posterior abdominal muscles. So below that posterior abdominal muscles, obturator and psoas, that cecum will be located. So when there is an inflamed appendix will be there, nearly its contact with the two muscles. So these are the two examination procedures where you have to move the right limb of the patient. That means the patient is lying down on the table. Patient is lying down on the table in that supine position and fold only one right leg. And fold only one right leg. If you fold the right leg and just rotate the right leg, move the right leg towards that one left one. Move that right leg. So one it is folded and move towards the this side over the left leg. Here you can get the pain in the right iliac fossa. Pain will becomes very worse at right iliac fossa. It took both the psoas as well as the obturator test. This is the obturator test. Psoas test means patient will be lying down on the table. One side right leg will be lie down. Make it to the patient leg. Make the patient to that come to the edge. At the edge, the leave that right leg below. So automatically that will be the psoas major muscle will be stretched. When the muscle will be stretched, the pain will be occur. Because both obturator and psoas muscles are related with the posterior abdominal wall, where the, behind that cecum, inflamed appendix will be resting on that. Particularly if that appendix will be retrocecal, that means in between the cecum as well as a major muscle and obturator muscle, that will be painful. When that movement will be takes place, contraction of our muscles will be and causes that pain. So these are the two tests will be very important. This test will be explains about the accuracy of that one, acute appendicitis along with the position. When that appendix will be located in a retrocecal position, it will be very clearly these will become positive. And features of a generalized peritonitis, sometimes the, along with this, the complete peritoneum will be inflamed. The features will be occur because of a implant. And rectal examination is very important here. Rectal examination, so as you know about that one, keeping the thermometer will be in the mouth is less important than that of the keeping the finger in the rectum, which will be completes that abdominal examination. So, to identify that rectal examination, any tenderness, differential tenderness, so any pelvic organs inflammation, you can identify by rectal examination. And if it's a female, you can go for the pervaginal examination. These are the signs and previous symptoms. By this, you can come to one point, along with a different diagnosis, you come to diagnose that one, acute appendicitis, and comes to the investigations. Here, so one tricky things are there about the investigations. It can depend upon the PVC because of the infection that is there. And second, you can depend upon that investigation. 100% true that one, WBC can explain about that infectious condition. Any infection can cause us that increase in the, but the accuracy of that acute appendicitis even will not known by the investigations. I think I told in the previous class about the investigations where that UVSC is a contraindicated in a GIT. So appendix is also one of the extension of the GIT. So again, the radiologist may not be provide that accurate thing for that appendicitis. They may be put the question. So most of the times, they will not comment on that. They can write that one. There may be some probe tenderness at the right ear fossa, and they put the diagnosis also with a question mark. Lastly, they will write that one. The clinical examination will be finalized. So for that purpose, most of the times, acute appendicitis is a only clinical condition. You can go for the clinical diagnosis pattern. You can use that UVSG simply to rule out the other than the diagnosis of the appendicitis. There will be stones on the right investigations. Okay, that's it about that up to the diagnosis of the appendicitis. So in the next class, we will go for the management of the appendicitis and whether when to go for the medical management, when to go for the surgical management, then what is the management, what is the management, subject to, then we will clarify that one. So before that, you have to go for that complete revision of this anatomy of the appendix, along with that the signs and symptoms of the appendix and its investigations. Just to go through it, we'll continue that same thing, the treatment of the appendix, appendicitis in the next class.